Hi guys, welcome back to Apocalypse. So I realise I haven't uploaded a lot of content this year. I've got a lot going on at the moment, all good things, nothing bad. But I am going to be pretty busy for the next 6 to 9 months. Obviously, this will mean that I won't be uploading much, and this will of course delay the release of my book. So for now, I just want to share some of my latest research with you, because I found some very compelling relationships between ancient sites across both sides of the Atlantic. But first, I need to make a correction to the timeline I created back in episode 10 of my Atlantis series. I spoke very briefly about the Mousterian Pluvial and how North Africa was in a wet and humid period between 50,000 and 30,000 years ago. I then went on to suggest that if a group of ancient hunter-gatherers figured out how to map the world, the likely origins of their geodetic discoveries began in the Rickat structure between 40,000 and 30,000 years ago, after the world recovered from the Lachamps geomagnetic excursion. Well, it turns out that the Mousterian Pluvial is now deemed to be an obsolete theory by the majority of archaeologists and geologists, and as it turns out, it was deemed obsolete decades ago. This doesn't really affect my timeline all that drastically, but I should have checked this more thoroughly before publishing episode 10. Long story short, I'm revising this part of the timeline from between 40,000 and 30,000 years ago to between 37,500 and 33,000 years ago. Let me explain why. Generally dated from 160,000 to 40,000 years ago, the Mousterian, not to be confused with the Mousterian Pluvial, was an industrial culture made up from Neanderthals in Europe and Homo sapiens in North Africa and West Asia, although it should be said that the Mousterian originated in North Africa 315,000 years ago, before spreading further north more than 150,000 years later. Before we continue, let me explain what I mean by industrial culture. In simple terms, it means that the people of the Mousterian shared a common level of technology with identical techniques for producing stone tools. The various peoples of the Mousterian might have had different belief systems or even different customs, but their stone tools would have been identical. A stone tool produced by a Neanderthal during the Mousterian would have been indistinguishable from one produced by a Homo sapien. Different species of human were either sharing knowledge or copying from one another. So this begs the question, why was the Mousterian Pluvial deemed obsolete? As I said just a few moments ago, the Mousterian Pluvial was implied to have taken place 50,000 to 30,000 years ago. This was based on the dating of Mousterian tools that were found in North Africa. They were dated using radiocarbon decay. Well, it turns out that the effective limit for radiocarbon dating lies between 40,000 to 35,000 years ago. More recent dating techniques tell us that these tools were produced between 130,000 years ago to 72,000 years ago, bang smack in the middle of the Mousterian proper. The Homo sapiens of North Africa made these tools not during the obsolete Mousterian Pluvial, but during the humid Eemian interglacial and even beyond into the throes of the next ice age, or from our perspective, the previous ice age. Now that we've cleared up the confusion around the obsolete Mousterian Pluvial, why have I redated my timeline to between 37,500 years ago and 33,000 years ago? Well, during the dry period in North Africa between 71,000 and 14,500 years ago, there were three semi-humid interruptions. The first was between 65,000 and 61,000 years ago. The second was between 52,500 and 15,500 years ago. And the last one took place between 37,500 years ago and 33,000 years ago. I'm adamant that the events in my timeline took place after the Lachamps geomagnetic excursion, so this only leaves us with the more recent dates of 37,500 and 33,000 years ago. And although these were not the wet and humid conditions found during the Eemian interglacial, North Africa was at least habitable and probably somewhat more favourable than parts of Europe, which were heading towards the coldest depths of the Ice Age. So if you haven't watched episode 10 yet, or if you want to rewatch it armed with this updated knowledge, please be my guest. I've placed a link in the description below. Now there's just one more cool thing that I want to share with you before we get into the ancient geodetic links found on both sides of the Atlantic. I mentioned just a few moments ago that the dry period in North Africa came to an end 14,500 years ago. Well, this is a very important date in our ancient past, as by this point in time, our planet was rapidly exiting the last ice age. Right on cue, just as dozens of other ice ages have come to an end over the last 2.58 million years of the Quaternary. But something happened to disrupt this warming event. Our planet was rapidly plunged back into the depths of the ice age for a few more millennia. Back in episode 10, I predicted that the sun might have gone into a period of low activity at this very date, and now it just so happens that a paper has recently been released that seems to back up this assertion. I won't go into too much detail, so I'll leave a link in the description below for anybody who is interested. So to cut to the chase, levels of beryllium-10 in ice core samples and levels of carbon-14 found in ancient tree rings, both dated to 14,300 years ago, very strongly suggest that the sun went into some kind of extended period of low activity, akin to a maunder minimum. Essentially, the usual pattern of quaternary ice ages and interglacials, which were largely dictated by variations in the Earth's axial tilt, axial precession and eccentricity of orbit, otherwise known as Milankovitch cycles, were now overridden by changes in solar output. Whether this reduction in solar activity was enough to disrupt the world's climate by itself is another question. What I will say, however, and this is my own speculation, is that a Heinrich event took place a little over 1,000 years prior. A Heinrich event is characterized by an abundance of icebergs melting in the Atlantic, disrupting thermohaline circulation patterns. Essentially, the global conveyor was also likely disrupted by this earlier and separate event. Given that the global conveyor takes roughly 1,000 years to go around the world, perhaps the Heinrich event compounded with the reduction in solar output then plunged us back into the Ice Age. Some key things to take away from this paper are that there was found to be an increase in carbon-14 levels in the tree rings for approximately a century. The very beginning of this event, however, is marked by the largest increase in the form of an abrupt spike of carbon-14. This spike was so abrupt that it took place within a single year, the same year as a beryllium-10 anomaly. This leads the authors of the paper to speculate that the cause was a probable solar energetic particle event, the largest recorded so far. The second largest took place only 1,250 years ago, and that was only half of the magnitude. In layman's terms, the beginning of this reduction in solar output was marked by a solar flare, or coronal mass ejection, one so powerful that the Earth was bombarded with extreme cosmic radiation. Now, events of this magnitude are rare, but we should take heed, as these events do occur frequently on a smaller scale. Given the abundance of satellites orbiting the Earth, and the fact that there are still some countries that don't have adequate countermeasures in place to protect their power infrastructure, we should be very careful, as our global culture is highly dependent on electronics and electricity. Okay, so let's get to the transatlantic relationships between ancient sites, as this is what you all came for. Most of you are probably already familiar with my proposed network of ancient observatories, shown in yellow. If not, you might want to go back to episode 8 and start watching from there. So we have my proposed site for Atlantis at the 3/7 line of latitude. We have Avebury at the 4/7 line of latitude, and we have Bimini at the 2/7 line of latitude. Finally, we have the Rickat structure, a natural feature that serves as the keystone of this particular network. This is because we need one observatory to sit below the Tropic of Cancer, as the Sun and the Moon sit directly overhead or at zenith at certain times of the year. I believe these observatories performed a number of functions, both locally and globally. They could be used for parallax measurements to calculate the distance to the Moon and the Sun. They were also likely used to chart the movements of the moon so that sailors, navigators, and geodetists could accurately pinpoint their longitude without the need for a chronometer. Twice a year, at the Rickat structure, the sun sits directly overhead or at zenith during high noon. The other three observatories could very accurately calculate the angular distance and bearing to the Keystone Observatory. This could be done using very simple tools such as a stick and an equatorial sundial. I will go into the maths and fine details in my book, but for now, let's move on and see if we can expand this observatory network. If we head over to the Yucatan in Mexico, we find Chichen Itza. You can see from the overlay that it fits into our observatory network. Like Avebury or Giza, Chichen Itza is a complex made from several different constructions. Of particular interest is El Caracol, as this is widely regarded to be a pre-Columbian observatory used by the Maya in the distant past. El Caracol just so happens to lie 72.00 degrees in arc distance from the east side of Avebury. This is exactly 1/5 of the circumference around the world, or 43,200 stadia. You'll notice 43,200 is a number that repeats over and over again in the ancient world. I understand that it's somewhat speculative, but I believe that certain ancient sites, such as Avebury, Giza, and Chichen Itza, have ancient roots that are far older than the constructions that are found there today. I believe that primitive Paleolithic structures such as earth mounds and henges constructed with wooden posts were replaced with more permanent structures, beginning in the Neolithic. For what reason, I don't know, perhaps to preserve these sites and this knowledge for future generations. Or perhaps, given enough time, these sites lost much of their practical significance, then simply went on to become places of worship or ceremony. Now, if we focus back on Chichen Itza, we can see that the largest construction here is El Castillo, better known as the Temple of Kukulcan. This temple is located at the top of a large four-sided step pyramid, built approximately 1,000 years ago. Remember though that I believe this complex has a much older origin, predating the modern constructions found there today. Many archaeologists believe the construction of the temple was based on the concept of the Axis Mundi. I really don't want to go over this again, but if you've watched episodes 8, 9 and 10, you will see how important this is to linking Chichen Itza to our ancient global observatory network. If you haven't watched episodes 8, 9 and 10, it might be a good idea if you want to understand exactly what might be going on. Now Kukulcan, for whom the temple is named after, is the serpent deity from Mayan mythology. His name translates to feathered or plumed serpent. This is very important, as to the west of Chichen Itza we find the ancient city of Teotihuacan, located 40 kilometers northeast of present-day Mexico City. Like Chichen Itza, Teotihuacan is another large complex. The third largest construction here is the Temple of Quetzalcoatl, a six-level step pyramid built somewhere between 1800 and 2000 years ago. So it turns out that Quetzalcoatl is the Aztec name for the same serpent deity, the feathered or plumed serpent, which makes sense as the Temple of Quetzalcoatl is adorned with representations of the feathered serpent. So here's where it gets really interesting, as we can see that the Temple of Quetzalcoatl is located 1,080 kilometers to the west of the Temple of Kukulcan, a number we see repeated in the ancient world, and part of a number system we see frequently in the ancient Near East. Moving on, we find that the Temple of Kukulcan is linked to Monk's Mound, part of the Cahokia complex in present-day Illinois. Monk's Mound is very important for two reasons. Firstly, it's the largest pre-Columbian earthwork in all of the Americas. Secondly, it lies on the 3/7 line of latitude, or what I'm calling the Axis Mundi. And I'm certainly not the first to note the significance of this particular latitude. You will probably have noticed that the three locations form a right-angled triangle, or at least from the perspective of an observer at Chichen Itza. I don't really want to get into spherical trigonometry, as the math that I've uncovered suggests that the geodesists of the ancient world didn't need to use it to make calculations. The important thing is the initial bearing can be observed in Chichen Itza, which does form a 90-degree angle. Now, when we measure the distance between Chichen Itza and Monk's Mound, we get a distance of 1,080 nautical miles, or 10,800 stadia. I really don't think this is a coincidence, as the kilometer, nautical mile, and stadia are all Earth measurements. The kilometer is 1/10,000th of the distance between the equator and the North Pole. The nautical mile is 1 minute of arc of a great circle using the modern 360-degree system, and the stadia is 1 second of arc using the ancient 60-degree circle. We can therefore say that 1 nautical mile is exactly 10 stadia. I don't want to dwell on the ancient number system for this video, as there's a lot going on and it certainly deserves its own dedicated episode. What I will say for now is that these numbers are very practical for ancient people who haven't yet discovered irrational numbers. For now, I want to concentrate on some mythology to conclude this episode, as the theme of the serpent is one that can be found on both sides of the Atlantic. In the ancient Egyptian story of the Island of the Egg, the falcon god does battle with the enemy serpent, the Great Leaping One, before the island is submerged beneath the primeval waters by some kind of cataclysm. The story is so old that the deities are unnamed. Over time, the story changes and the deities take on names that we recognize today. The falcon god becomes Horus, and the Great Leaping One becomes Set or Seth. In the Old World, the Abrahamic religions eventually take over. They borrow heavily from the pagan creation stories and mythologies that came before. Set or Seth becomes Satan, the serpent in the Garden of Eden. Perhaps it's no coincidence that Quetzalcoatl was strongly associated with the Morning Star, one of the Latin names given to Lucifer. So what does this all mean? I can only speculate, but perhaps like the cult of the Seshu Hor or people of Horus, there might have been a Seshu Set, a cult dedicated to the serpent deity. If these two cults fell foul of one another, they might have gone on to demonize each other's gods. This might explain the issue of trying to equate the principal avian creator god of the Maya, its Samana, with the demon bird Vukubkakwi. Both seemingly shot by the hero twins, many suggest that these two deities are one in the same, one iteration revered, the other demonized. Well, that's all I've got for now. I'll upload another video at Christmas. Cheers.